you tell us everything you know about Washington.
Well, thank you. Thank you, guys. It's great being here, as always. Thank you all so much. This is such an amazing county. You guys are always handle everything so well. I just appreciate you. Our law enforcement here tonight, thank you for keeping us all nice and safe.
Yes.
This county is a very low crime rate in the region. But really, I just want to thank y'all for coming out because, you know, there would be easy to get disheartened with the things going on, not only in our country, but in our world today. War is breaking out. You know, in Revelation, where it talks about there will be wars and rumors of wars. I think that's exactly what we're seeing. You know, we're seeing a lot of misinformation, a lot of propaganda come out on all sides of this Ukrainian situation, right, from the Russians, from the Ukrainians, from our own mainstream media. It's hard to make sense of it. Even in my position where I get to hear intelligence reports, you know, each department has different thoughts on the whole thing. Everybody's giving differing information. So this is one thing I just encourage you all, please be praying for our leaders as they're trying to wade through this. There's so many people who make a lot of money from war. And there's a lot of people who want to drag us into war when I don't believe that is in our national interest. You know, Washington very astutely warned us from getting involved in foreign entanglements, mainly because at the time the country was at a very precarious place. It was not the safest, it was not the most well set up. It was a brand new country, it was a brand new experiment, this whole idea of a Republican democracy. And now that when we're starting to look at what's going on in the country and in the world, we look back to our country, and I feel like we're at a time similar to our founding, when our country's in a precarious place. And the reason we are seeing this uncertainty and this chaos on the world stage is a direct result because of the domestic policies taken by the Biden regime here. It is a direct result from Russia being able to feel like they have the leverage over people in the European Union, over Germany, over many other people in the world, because we have decided to handicap and sanction ourselves when it comes to oil and energy production.
That's right.
I mean, we were a net exporter of energy on January 19th of 2020. And then the very first day that Joe Biden was in office, he decided to shut down the Keystone Pipeline. They decided to make sure that there was no new federal leases for any kind of drilling on federal land or doing any kind of fracking. They have cracked down on being able to drill for oil off almost all of our seaboards and all of our coasts. And because of that, we are not only seeing problems going on in Ukraine and then the sadness and the tragedy that's happening there with civilians being killed. But even worse than that, we are starting to see, we got WLS right up there, our favorite people. But even worse than that, we're starting to see now that we have gas prices that are going through the roof. I didn't pass a gas station on the way. What are the gas prices right now in Rutherford?
$4.19.
It's insane. Then when you start thinking of the off-roading diesel that our agriculture industry needs, that's well over $5. On the West Coast, it's hitting $6, $7 already. And, you know, we've started to try and stabilize the market a little by releasing some of our strategic reserve. But that is just an idea for them to try and what they think can help them in the midterms. The strategic reserve is not made for helping yourself in the midterms. The strategic reserve is in case we ever go to war, our Air Force and our Navy will be able to keep their ships in the air and on the water. That is the whole reason for it. And so when we're starting to see what's going on in this world today, please, our leaders in this country have got to start legislating, making policies that are for the people. Not ideas that are for whichever special interest group owns them or whatever it is. And I will tell you, this idea of the uniparty, these people who are all in Washington, D.C. and are all friendly, they fight on the news, but then when they get all behind closed doors, they're all buddy-buddy. I knew there probably was some of that. I really did. You know, just some people who were political opportunists and they didn't care if they ran as Democrat or Republican. But now that I've gotten to Washington, I realize it is such a deep-rooted issue. I expected to have, you know, 100, 150 at least Republicans that I could count on that were like all of us from Western North Carolina. It's not true. I mean, there are maybe 30, 40 Republicans that I say really have our best interests at heart. The rest, once they get there, most of them get elected as great patriots. They really do. But the establishment has such an allure to it. And once you walk around on those marble floors for too long or behind your velvet ropes, get your security detail, the bulletproof windows, you start saying, well, maybe we do have better, maybe we can centrally plan ideas better than the 330 million Americans. Maybe us 535 members of Congress and the Senate combined. We can make better decisions for all the country. But we in this room all know that is absolutely incorrect. I mean, these people in Washington are so arrogant to believe that they can rule our lives better than we can. I mean, God gave us free will. And our government right now, these socialist governments, are trying to take that away from people.
That's right.
And I will tell you what's going on with our children in this country right now, the indoctrination that's happening. Has anybody heard the word the Don't Say Gay bill from Florida?
Yes.
So they're saying that Florida has issued a bill in their House of Representatives to say that you're not allowed to say the words gay. But that's not even in the bill whatsoever. It's called the Parental Bill of Rights and Education. And the only thing it has in there that has anything to do with anything that has anything to do with the LGBT community is that children under the age of 8 cannot have a discussion with their teachers about their sexual orientation or what any kind of these sexually explicit acts mean and what they are. And now they're trying to raise, they're raising Cain about it. And you saw just recently our own Lieutenant Governor Mark Robinson was attacked because he said, you know, in our elementary schools, we should not have homosexual pornography in our elementary schools. And they raked him over the coals. And my friends, at what point did we think that children need to be taught about sexual education before the age of 10, before the age of 15 even? It is so dangerous. It's so ridiculous. And the reason is because, I mean, there are so many people in Washington who just, they partake in sexual exploitation all the time. Mm-hmm. And I will tell you all, the corruption in Washington goes so deep, but in as much as we need term limits on the House of Representatives and the Senate, which I believe is so woefully needed because, I mean, the majority of the people I serve with, so many of them, have been in office for longer than I've been alive. And we see what's happened with these people who have paid their dues and waited in line. Well, our country's $30 trillion in debt. We have a porous southern border. We have sex trafficking, drugs, cartels coming in. We now are having to pay ridiculous amounts for our gas. And just the one thing that I really want to harp on when it comes to the energy costs is that it doesn't just affect you when you pay at the pump. It affects the transportation of all goods and all services all across the country. And it just jacks the prices up everywhere you go. And this is something where I think our country needs to start focusing on dining room politics. What affects our young families with young children around the dinner table at all times? Do they want to have their children be able to go to a good school? Are they going to get a good education? They're going to want to make sure their children are safe. Our streets are safe. Our law enforcement is thanked and honored for the service that they give to our country. Our veterans are not sitting homeless on the side of the streets. We have a good economy. You can raise children and a family with peace and prosperity on a single income. I mean, that's the economy. I want our economy to be so strong that only the mother or the father needs to go out to work, and you don't need two incomes to be able to get ahead in life.
That's right.
But I'll tell you, these people in Washington, I mean, I'm sure you see that. Obviously, I didn't drive here tonight, if anybody, it's because the mainstream media has been going crazy because I got a traffic ticket. But, you know, they want to focus on dividing us on the most needless of things about race and religion and all these things, when all of us could come together as Americans and say, we're going to put our country first. We're going to put our families first. We're going to put our communities first. And we would be the strongest, most independent, greatest country in the world. And, you know, one of the reasons we've had so much peace and prosperity in the world for the last 80 years since the fall, the end of World War II, is because in Europe, almost every single piece of manufacturing was absolutely destroyed by both sides. But America had its strong manufacturing base on the homeland. They were able to lead the world in their economy, able to lead the world in energy production and innovation. And our country was strong. But we've lost that recently. And that is why we're starting to see the chaos that's going on in this world. And so I realize that I might not be every single Republican's cup of tea. I realize that sometimes if you have any liberal family members, it might not be the most fun thing to bring up at Thanksgiving saying, well, my congressman's Madison Cawthorn. I realize I've got tattoos and I'm pretty rough with the way I speak, and sometimes I can seem a little extreme. But my friends, I believe that we live in extreme times. I don't think that there's any time for us to wait and just play these genteel politics games where we say, oh, well, you know, you do whatever you want to do so long as it doesn't hurt anybody else. I mean, that's what I used to really think before I got to Washington. But then I met our enemy. And I'm not saying my colleagues, I'm saying our enemy. Because there are so many people in Washington who are socialists, want to create atheism as the religion of the world, and they want to take away everything that we believe in as Americans. And those people do not sleep. They are completely committed. They never turn on their own, and they march forward endlessly, and they never back down. And I am so tired of 6 decades of Republicans who have been kneeling and backing down inch by inch by inch, thinking that, oh, well, maybe they'll start liking me on MSNBC and maybe CNN will give me a good news conference. My friends, I don't really care what they call me in the mainstream press, because the mainstream press is, these people, they hate us. They truly do. And at the end of the day, it's not them who called me to this position. The people that called me to the position are God Almighty, the people of Western North Carolina. They truly are. But I know if you guys, I say this every time, but if anybody wanted to hear a politician speak, I'm sorry I've gotten coughing so much, but if anybody wanted to hear a politician speak, you just turn on the news at any time. So if you guys have any questions, I'd love to take some questions. That's all right with y'all. Yes, sir.
Vietnam veteran, been through Agent Orange. And of course, we've been through hell in the last couple of years with this virus that's been around the world. It was shocking to find out that we were involved in the Wuhan lab. The other day, in a congressional session, a member of the administration was asked, are we involved in bio labs in the middle of that war over there in Ukraine? And she answered, yes. You know anything more about that?
I do. So this was floating around. It was kind of a conspiracy theory. And if you talked about bio labs in Ukraine on social media just a few days ago, you would have been censored and kicked off social media right away. But then Senator Marco Rubio asked the Undersecretary of State if we have any bio labs over there, and what do they look like? And then she confirmed that, yes, we do have bio labs over there, and she then said that it's classified. We can't tell you where they all are, especially because of the war. And this really raises some concerns for me because, you know, we just had Anthony Fauci, who blatantly lied to Congress, saying we were not involved in any gain-of-function research in the Wuhan Institute of Virology. That was proved patently false, and that's the number one reason I want to investigate and send Anthony Fauci to jail.
Yes. So, amen.
And so when I hear that we have biolaboratories overseas, one, you know, a lot of people want, there's so many people like to brag about this and the international partnerships. I believe it was Barack Obama in 2004 who went over there and set all of these biolabs up in Ukraine. And the only reason we now were able to know to ask that question is because you can archive basically everything on the internet, go back and search the history as if you were searching for something in 2014. Now, if you go back in time on some of these systems that exist, and you Google about our bio labs in Ukraine back in 2014 or 2013, there were article after article about them bragging about the international cooperation. But then the reason we knew to ask these questions, and I applaud Marco Rubio for asking the question, is because if you were to Google those today, they're completely erased from all the internet. And so my question is, what do they have to hide? If we were involved in gain-of-function research, and gain-of-function research is basically where you're trying to mutate a virus or some kind of a pathogen or something. In Wuhan, we added spike proteins to something to make an animal virus then be transmissible to humans. My question is, one, this is very clearly the only reason you want to create that is because you want some form of a bioweapon. And so when we start looking into this, My fear is that we are involved in gain-of-function research there. That is not proven yet. I'm sure there's going to be an investigation.
It's a war zone.
It's a war zone, exactly. And so what happens if there's a stray missile that hits one of these things? Or what happens if somebody recklessly lets one of these go while they're trying to run away from the Russian forces? Then all of a sudden we're going to have another virus on the world stage. And so this is a reason why I think we really need to get the NIH, the National Institute of Health, under control. We need to start putting some more congressional oversight into this, because this is not working in the best interest of Americans or of humanity in general to be creating these bioweapons which can be released and then damage millions and millions of people. And thankfully, the coronavirus was, you know, we had a 99% survival rate. All the lives that were lost because of it, it's very, very sad. But, you know, we saw what happened when they released this. We fell into an area where our entire country has now fallen even further away from the idea of independence and freedom that we used to have. I mean, right now, when we're looking at what's going on in our country, we realize that these people, and a lot of, you know, I used to think it was kind of a bunch of conspiracy theories. But if you go back and you look at the World Economic Forum and you start hearing them talk about the Great Reset and hearing about them wanting to be able to use the coronavirus to issue in a lot of these more government controls, you realize that is their exact plan. They, and you know, as Barack Obama's chief of staff once said, never let a good crisis go to waste. And that's exactly how they feel about these. And so my fear is that, yes, I do believe we are participating in gain-of-function research. That's not proven yet, but we do know that we do have bio labs that we are involved in overseas in Ukraine. And it's the middle of a war zone. And why in the world, when you know that Russia and Ukraine are two of the countries that have always had the most problems with each other, would you put these biolabs on the eastern side of Ukraine right up against the border? It doesn't make any sense. And so it's I don't have a lot of answers for you, but yes, it is 100% true that we do have biolabs there. Yeah. Any other questions? Yes, ma'am.
We know that our vote will actually count what we're voting instead of being changed.
Well, ma'am, I cannot speak for the rest of the country. I can speak for North Carolina. You know, one, I wish that we had audited North Carolina's election.
Yes.
Because, one, I have no idea how Dan Forrest is not our governor right now. But, two, I know that I would have won by a whole heck of a lot more if we kicked out a lot of these absentee ballots.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But, there. So what's going on with this? And I actually... Dan Forrest, Chief of Staff, Hal Weatherman works here. He runs my district. He's incredible. One of the only good things that came out of Dan Forrest not being our governor is I got the greatest political operative in the entire state on my staff. But now, obviously, Hal has been involved in campaigns where he's both won and lost them. He's seen them from both sides. And so it has been a very righteous mission that he has been on since the end of that campaign. He's launched a nonprofit, totally separate from me and my organization, but he's launched a nonprofit which is here to secure our votes in North Carolina.
Right.
And so let me just paint a picture for you. And if you guys ever want Hal to come down and explain it in detail, I'll let him. But I'll just give you a 30,000-foot view. So the North Carolina voter registration file, it's about 7.9 million people. Is that roughly correct, Hal?
Yeah, fluctuates. 8.2 million is down to about 7.8.
So it's between 7.8 and 8.2 million. Now, each one of those people, they all generate about 300 lines of code in our voter registration file. And so that takes a lot of data to be able to store all of that. And so just imagine how asinine this is. Whenever the North Carolina voter file is updated from day to day, it gets rid of everything that used to exist. So Hal's organization now takes a digital snapshot of that voter file that then looks for the movements that most correlate with fraud. Because the only, and I tried as hard as I could to try and kick out this fraudulent election we had in 2020. I mean, I was there to debate on a lot of these states, but unless you're able to really mobilize and challenge an election within the first 10 days, it's virtually impossible to end it. It's virtually impossible to stop it. And so what Hal's organization does is it takes that digital snapshot of the voter file. And then let's say somebody showed up to early voting on the first day of early voting, because we have an early voting season now instead of just election day, which is ridiculous. If someone was to show up and vote, let's say, for candidate A, but then you receive a mail-in ballot, you know, 4 days later that says they're voting for candidate B, it would record their vote as voting for candidate B, and it would erase any record that they had done that before. And so Hal's organization will now be able to pinpoint all those people whose votes have either changed or votes look kind of suspicious. And then instead of having to look through 7.9 to 8.3 million people, it's now narrowed down to about 50,000 people, and which is almost always going to come from Wake County, if you know what I'm saying. So I will tell you, I'm very confident in Hal's work. So I believe that our elections here in North Carolina are going to be phenomenal. And I'm hoping that we can patently prove that it was his organization that was able to get that to really secure our elections. And then if it works well here, we want to take that nationwide. I want him to. That's not my organization. But anyway, so Hal's really doing God's work in that. But I hope that gives you some peace of mind in that, ma'am. Yeah. Anybody else?
What about the insurrection that happened on January 6th and the people that are still sitting in jail and been crucified and all kinds of terrible things have been happening to them on a daily basis? What's happening with that?
So I will tell you that really the greatest warriors we have on that have been Marjorie Taylor Greene and Tucker Carlson. I mean, they've done a great job of blowing the lid on this and showing what's going on in this D.C. jail. For those of you that don't know, a lot of the people who were inside of the Capitol building, and there were some violent people up at the very front. One, I don't believe they were Trump supporters. You know, I think they were just anarchists who pre-staged this and were ready for it way ahead of time. But then there were some people who were just there. You know, slap them with a trespassing fine. That's fine. But don't treat them like they're mass murderers. I mean, it's absolutely insane. And so, really, until we get the majority back in Congress, we will not be able to launch an investigation that can really see justice happen. But we've done all we can to really kind of shed light on this. And it's kind of now most of, at least half the country is pretty aware of it. But there are people, and please be praying for them, because whether they took the vaccine or not determine if they're allowed to go to religious services while they're inside of the jail. I mean, and so just imagine these people are being so held captive and their rights are being just trampled upon. But I will say they tried to say that I was an insurrectionist. And so therefore, because of the 14th Amendment, the North Carolina Board of Elections was not going to allow me to run for Congress. Well, I have gotten very good news. We decided to file a case in federal court against the North Carolina Board of Elections. And I will tell you, as of Friday around 10:35 a.m., the judge completely kicked it out, and we are now completely good to be able to run for Congress. And so, but one of the most important things of that is, one, I'm glad I get to continue to represent you and run for Congress again. But two, it's now set a legal precedent that it was not an insurrection, that it's absolutely patently false what they're trying to peddle and what they're trying to say. James O'Keefe of Project Veritas had a really great leaked video from a New York Times reporter who was saying, oh yeah, we're just overblowing this because to help with the midterms and all these things. And so we realize it's political theater, but unfortunately there are good Americans who are suffering because of it. And so please keep it in your prayers. But once we take the majority back, I will personally, if nobody else steps up, I will lead the charge to get an investigation of this and try and see justice done.
That's right.
Yeah. Anybody else?
Yeah, Congressman.
Yes, sir.
We got this mess in the Eastern Europe there with Ukraine and all that. And I know you've made some reference to President Zelensky being a thug or being, you know, in the government being corrupt. I think we're all trying to figure this thing out. I mean, it seems like we're on the precipice of a possible major disaster. Can you clarify some of that for us so we know where we stand with all of that?
I will. So, one, as I was saying earlier, there's so much propaganda coming out on all sides of this, both from Russia, from Ukraine, from a lot of other countries involved, from our own media, that things are becoming so murky and hard to understand. But before we all jump to a conclusion and say we're going to go defend a democracy in Eastern Europe, we have to realize that the Ukrainian government is so well known for corruption. It's one of the major sex trafficking hubs of the entire world, not that area. The Ukrainian people are wonderful people. There's a lot of really great people, and those who are patriotically fighting for their freedom, I commend them. They're doing great. But this is not a country that, you know, I feel like is the shining beacon of what really truly is the standard of a good and clean and transparent government. And so there was a lot of corruption that's been there. You know, in 2014, there was basically a regime change that happened. There's just a lot of questions and questionable issues going on there. I do plan on releasing in detail in a few weeks just kind of some ideas and some thoughts that I have on that. But I want to make sure that we have every single fact completely dialed down for that. But I will just tell you, honestly, both governments in both Russia and in Ukraine are incredibly corrupt and very vile. The Ukrainian people are wonderful people. I don't want there to be war over there at all. But I do not believe that we should be sending our troops, our sons and daughters, to go die for another country. Because, I mean, we've been at war for basically my entire life in the Middle East. And we saw exactly what happened when we tried to withdraw from Afghanistan. And we spent, you know, trillions of dollars in 20 years in blood and so many lives lost and so many veterans. People, they're not dealing with Agent Orange, my friend, but they're you know, people who are... I get to go in Washington, D.C., I get to go to Walter Reed, and I see so many of our wounded veterans that are up there. And it just breaks my heart, you know, people who needlessly died just to fight in Afghanistan to replace the Taliban with better equipment. And so I fear that this would be a very similar case if we got involved in Ukraine, except instead of fighting against the Taliban, we'd be fighting against major powers of the world. If we get involved, then China gets involved. That would constitute that NATO has to all get involved. And I mean, it, for all practical purposes, would be World War III right away. And I will tell you, some of the weapons we have at our disposal now that other countries have at their disposal as well, not just speaking about nukes, it would usher in a new era of warfare that would be like nothing the world has ever seen. The 21st century warfare, you know, it'll most likely be cyber and all those things. But if we release some of the worst weapons that we have, millions of people around this world would die.
So what should be our intervention there, if there should be an intervention? I mean, it's hard to stand by and watch the atrocities that are happening. It's just like, it's our modern day Hitler. I mean, and to watch that happen, what do we do to assist but not create a World War III?
So, number one, and I believe this is, you know, to be able to stop somebody from doing something, you need to have an imminent physical threat of harm on them. I mean, I talked to President Trump. He said the way he kept Vladimir Putin from ever getting involved in Ukraine, and this has to have happened before an invasion, can't happen post-invasion, but he told Vladimir when he called him to and congratulate him on his victory in 2016, that if you go one inch into Ukraine, I will bomb Moscow within the hour. I mean, that was strong leadership. But also, President Trump utilized our leverage that we have here in America, where we were able to basically make their oil reserves and their liquid natural gas and their heavy crude that they have in Russia, be completely meaningless because we produce so much more than they did. And so, number one, I think it's just, you know, drill absolutely everything. I mean, I want to see oil rigs off all of our coasts drilling for oil. I want to see all of our Americans going to work. I want to see the Keystone Pipeline reignited. I want to make sure that we're going to see all of our federal lands be allowed to be drilled upon. And because if you want to create clean, environmentally conscious energy, you do it here in America. I mean, that's exactly what we do. And now that we're trying to say, oh, well, you know, we're not going to buy Russian oil, but now we're going to go buy it from the Maduro regime in Venezuela, who's committing atrocities against their people as well. It's very sad. Another thing is I'm totally in favor of sending arms and aid to Ukraine. I mean, I would like to see every single one of their citizens with a Stinger missile in the living room. And so if you want to fly a jet over their place, let's watch Russian jets fall to the ground. Because, I mean, they are currently, we know they've bombed a maternity ward. We know that they've done some really terrible things, but again, there is a lot of propaganda around this on all sides. And so I know as all of us as good-hearted Americans, we don't like to see any violence against innocent people. I mean, it's against our nature. It's why we got involved in World War II. And, well, really, after Pearl Harbor. But really, I mean, I'm glad we did get involved in World War II because there was great evil happening. But I do not believe that we need to send any American men, service women, or men, or any of our no-fly zone jets to be able to get over there and get involved. It would just be any catastrophe. But so anyways, drilling for oil, creating energy here in America, and sending arms that they can use, which don't constitute war on our part, I think that's totally fine.
Thank you.
Yes, sir.
You brought up the XL, and there seems to be some confusion between the Keystone and the XL Keystone. Is the Keystone, which is the old system, been around for a long time? It is not being used now?
No, sir. The Keystone Pipeline is still being used.
Yeah,
the Keystone XL Pipeline is not. But the problem is that the Keystone XL Pipeline was going to be somewhere that would touch a lot of other areas. Because even if you could drill for oil or liquid natural gas in areas, if you don't have a pipeline to be able to get it to market, it doesn't mean anything. And so I hope that clarifies that one, sir.
Well, I thought that, but I mean, I'm hearing a lot of people, it's all the Keystone shut down, but now what's been going since 2010 or something?
Yes, sir.
And the XL is actually a pipeline extension of that to cover other areas, take oil into Texas, the refineries, and the exports.
Yes, sir. You're absolutely correct. But also the Biden regime has done something very diabolical because obviously it costs a lot of money for these oil companies to be able to create the infrastructure needed to be able to harvest natural gas and harvest any oil in our country, on our continent. But they've now started pressuring big banks and moneylenders to say, really saying that they'll create new taxation on them and create a lot of problems for them if they lend any money to these oil companies. And so it's creating an entire debacle where really you need 8 or 9 different puzzle pieces to all fit together for this to be able to work out well, to be able to create energy here in America. And so right now, I think in January 19th of 2020, we were creating about 14 million barrels of oil every single day. Not every single day, but we were creating about 14 million barrels of oil. And then now we're down to just a little under 10 million barrels of oil. My numbers might be a little bit off, but as that starts to decline, we start, you know, see 30-40% reduction in production. I mean, this is the cost of it. Now we're all going to have to pay more at the pump, whereas if we had continued with the Trump-era policies, we would be creating more energy by almost twofold than Russia, Saudi Arabia, and Iran all combined. And that would give us the ultimate power in the world.
Seems simple, doesn't it?
It does, yeah.
Common sense.
I mean, and this is the whole thing. I work with a lot. I was homeschooled. I didn't graduate from college. I'm just a good old boy from the mountains. And I think that if we had more people that just wore work boots or that spoke a little bit of an accent in Washington, D.C., instead of all these people with these Ivy League degrees who try to make things seem so falsely convoluted. And make no mistake, geopolitics and a lot of these decisions we have to make in Washington are very complicated. But at the end, the true cause and the real basis of it, the solutions are pretty simple. Let Americans work, keep our streets safe, fund police departments, fund our military, let's take care of our veterans. I mean, it all makes a lot of sense. Get rid of the federal income tax, put term limits on Washington, D.C., get rid of bureaucrats, put Fauci in jail, and everything's fine. Well, everybody, I want to thank you all. all so much for coming out. I'm going to stay around and shake everybody's hand if you guys want to hang out. Also, if anybody wants to get involved in our campaign and help us really, really keep America red and have this red wave happen, you've got Jonathan Harp over here who is wearing a Let's Go Brandon hat, so he's probably the most patriotic out of the two. And then you've got Brenda over there. They've got sign-up sheets if anyone wants to sign up or anything, or if you need any information about us. But anyways, thank you all so much for coming out. Really appreciate it.
Thank you. Very nice
to
meet you.
Hi, Andy Dan. Nice to meet you.
Hey, sir. How are you?